conversations on social issues of spring quarter 2017. My name is Kimberly Tate Malone, and I'm one of the reference and instruction librarians here at the college library. Thank you for being here. The library hosts this session every week because we see it as an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. So we come together once a week to discuss various topics. As you may know, April is National Poetry Month, and so today we have Leija Farr. But before we introduce this phenomenal young woman, I wanted to invite other folks to just know that all of these materials up here are on topic or different books of poetry or books about writing. And if you're interested, you're able to check any of those out. And we also love having students, faculty, staff, community members come and lead these. So if you are passionate about a topic and want a platform, you can come talk to me about leading a conversation on social issues session. So next week, we have the five Val Turners with the title Civic Disobedience Against Big Oil. But this today, we have Seattle's first youth poet laureate, a Seattle Central College student, a phenomenal writer, and from what I know, a wonderful person, Leija Farr. Please join me in welcoming Leija.
The title of my book is called Outweigh the Gravity. So I'm just going to be doing a few poems in my book. Mostly in this book, I discuss a lot of topics around social injustices, which I think is very important to me. I see my poetry as an act of protest, and so I use my creativity as a platform on issues that are affecting our communities. The first poem I'm going to do is, I guess, one of my most popular poems is called To Black Boys. A lot of people connect to it because I made this poem after the officer that shot Mike Brown wasn't indicted. And I felt that a lot of times in our society, black men are dehumanized and made to seem like they're animals and they're not told of their beauty. It's more of a feminine kind of characteristic. And I think that within the black male community, there's a lot of toxic masculinity, and they feel like they can't identify as beautiful. But I wanted to tell them that it's okay to be a black man and be beautiful. So this first poem is called For Black Boys. Delicate black boy, soldier, plum-painted spirit, deep-rooted dreamer. I can tell from the oceans on your bed that you've never been told you were beautiful. Mother didn't remind you of rainbows and her malleable inside. She soaked you in songs, but never self-love. Never explained the pink hue of your lips or the mole that marked your spine. You later saw mirrors and didn't memorize the letters of beauty, so you couldn't recite them. You didn't know your magic. That lovemaking on a Sunday was your conception. No one could dismiss that you had a shine oozing from your collarbone when you were born at 6 a.m. You glow in the dark. You are a poem. Boys can be roses. Boys have hearts. They need love. You have amputated your stomach for relief from the world, relief from what they feed you. That black boys don't need love, only bullets. That they'll find warmth in a barrel before they can bear it. Reflection, they lie to you. Black boys bleed every month. They are left with miles of blood clot, the hymns of their brothers. They leak the blood of the murder, the red liquid that drowns concrete, drowns tomorrow, drowns the pigment of their skin. You are a black boy that sheds. Finding yourself in these science experiments with your flesh, not trying to be heartless, not wanting to be in pain any longer, wanting to be told you are flawless, you are a work of art, standing in the light so it can reveal the shades of magic, your blood, the shades of black boy beautiful that paint the world, but you were never told that you are acrylic and you are unique, something that takes time to love, something that takes time to believe in. Your mother should have whispered in her pregnancy to you. She should have put you to bed with the words that hold off revolutions. Beauty would stop the war. Women are not the only ones that need to know their value. These TVs and politics won't deny them of hearts they love, no matter what. delicate black boy. You bleed every month. Your ribs leak the sea of last night's massacre. The next night, your legs will drip and stain like an unattended Sharpie. You will crest at the edges of your hips, tattoo at the angles of your chin with those stories. You go through pain too. You do not birth humans, but you birth the world. Every single day you wake up, I tell you, in a place that will never understand you are amazing, in a place that will put fire to you, then say you are callous. They will burn you, then say you are reckless. Some others won't tell you because they think it is feminine and they want to prepare you for a battlefield your whole life, but I tell you, you are beautiful, you are grand, you are too permanent to be unloved. You will heal this place when it is full of scars, full of scabs, full of stitches. You will be the one to erase the pain. Beauty is a tongue you will learn to speak. Pass this to the young brother on the corner, who's been told his body is a mixture of oil and water. Pass it to every brother, delicate black boys, soldiers. Beauty is a tongue you will learn to speak. Thank you.
Scatter.
ashes over the autobiography of the Savage Shakur. Let the remnants of my body become bookmarks in the pages. Unravel my jar of ash unto the beauty of her skin, the stanzas of her melanin. Let my ash dance around the battles of her life. Let me stain each chapter, each word. Let me feel her when her boom was simplified to a whisper. Asada, you have been escaping the bounty. You have poetry packaged in the envelopes of your mind. Some may never know this. They will not convince me you are a terrorist. I will not be brainwashed. So I prefer the pebbles of my body to lay along the creases, to sink into the ink, to consume the words of a woman who has a war forever scattered behind her. From a poem in my book. I was searching for a title and people were like, you know, why don't you name it after a phrase that you have in the book? So I was looking and looking. Birds in Blackness is the name of this poem, and I'm talking about in our society how black girls and boys at birth were set up in these marginalized situations where it's very hard for us to break barriers, and it's very hard for us to reach the ceiling of whatever institution is set up for us, whether it be the school system, whether it be the judicial system, just a whole bunch of systems that we are oppressed in. And so, from the time that we're born. And so, I was just thinking about how, as a black woman, how hard it's been for me to just succeed and break certain stereotypes that are set against me, whether it be that I'm angry, whether it be that I'm loud, whether it be that I speak too much and my opinion is just, you know, too much to have. So this poem is called Birds in Blackness. They say black girls and boys soar at night, that we have set sail over the craters of moon and rays of sun, that we have collided numerous times, that our wings have been trying to outweigh the gravity, that we scream from the world trying to pull us down. They say, so many of us have feathers from a littered ocean, say black mothers' wombs are nothing but caved in black hole, that we burst extinction, that black suns will lose their ability to soar. They say we are black birds whose nests are bloody, rigged with bullet holes, lingering with the sounds of chirps from a dying black bird. Say our limbs are meant to shatter, meant to break before the sun rises. They have been migrating us for years now, equating our blackness with crow for years now, trying to make us weak, to shoot us down from the sky, to capture us and tell us we are animals, nothing else. They are trying to make us seasonal, brainwash us to believe we cannot fly. Thank you. So, one poem I have in this book, I don't remember the section. This is right before my last section, which is called To Pimp a Womb, which is a play on Kendrick Lamar. I don't know if you guys know, he's a rapper. He has an album called To Pimp a Butterfly. And I thought it would like be cool to play on that a little bit, because in my last chapter, I'm talking about womanhood, and especially how women in our society, we are made to be less than men. And we have to fit in these certain boxes that are set up for us. So right before that chapter is, I mean, right before that section, I have a section called Where the Dirt Does Not Settle. And I finished that section with a poem called Gentrification, where I model gentrification as a woman and as her birthing something and watching it be taken away from her. You see that in Seattle, that a lot of gentrification has been going on, whether you go to the CD, whether you go to Yesler. There's just a lot of changes within our society it's sad to see, especially since I was born and raised here, and my city's changing. So this poem is called Gentrification. The neighborhood is ovulating, flooded with fertile soil. It yearns, wants to know she gave birth to something, that her babies have not left her. She hears the stories of other women. Central District was split at the tongue. Yesler begged for her life. South End has dreams she's the next victim. The neighborhood has been told to lie down. Relax, breathe in, breathe out, to wake with crooked operation on her hyphenated body. Thank you.
I'm the computer.
Okay. Let's see. How are you guys doing today? Okay. This one is from the first section of my book called Translate. I was already talking about womanhood and how women often feel like we have to fit in these narratives and these boxes that are set up for us. This one is about black women specifically, because I am a black woman, and just the amount of misogyny that has been attributed to black women, whether it be in certain rap lyrics that you hear, whether it be in just artists that take out their anger on black women, whether it be how you see we're standing at the front of the protest, but we're disrespected in so many different ways. So I think it's important that black women be cherished and not treated and not dehumanized in a way. But that has been happening repeatedly throughout our history. It's kind of cyclical and it needs to be stopped. So this poem is called Translate. Black woman, translation angry, translation pimped out bodies, translation inferior, translation dirt, graphite, and charcoal. Translation unwanted. Translation bristled hair. Translation gentrified bodies. Translation pomade. Translation easy to open. Translation untamed. Translation roar and thunder. Black woman. When will they realize these translations are gibberish? That they are not converting us correctly? They have tried to pry us open and we did not let them. They are trying to assassinate us daily with their words. Real definition. Black woman, origin, queens, defined as the survivor of dismantling, the body in front of the protest, the sacrifice for her children, the Afro pick, the butterfly, the holding grounds of galaxies, the mane of millions of curls, the spectrum of skin, the beautiful body, the night sky at its greatest hour forever blooming, the depths of the water opening itself, the magic, the back that has carried so much weight, the martyrs of social media, used in a sentence. The world has tried to defeat the black woman. It was unsuccessful. I think a lot of times in our society, we like to put black men and women against each other. We like to say, you know, well, you see what these black men are doing to these black men, or what these black men are doing to these black women. I think that we, now more than ever, when we have Trump in office, we need to be coming together, and we need to be using our resources and our power to create, to manifest something better than what we're doing. Which is why I think intersectionality is very important at this time, whether it be intersectional feminism, which is super important because the history of feminism was led by white women. And so if we're gonna have women's marches and we're gonna have different events going on, we need to make sure that we're including all spectrums of people. Let's see. I've read these poems so many times. Okay. This one is called The Skills of Life. I think that in our society, we're trying to survive, and we're not doing these protests because it's fun, or we're doing them because, you know, it's a nice activity to do on a weekend or whatever. We're doing it because we want to live. And it's hard to live when you have so many things set up against you. It's hard to live, and it's hard to feel like you can even breathe, you know, take a second to breathe. So this one's called The Skills of Life. I made it because I feel like living in our society really is, it feels like it is, you have to have skills to do it. And it seems like it's becoming harder to just breathe. So this one's called The Skills of Life. The skills of keeping alive. When feet have tried to push you down into the soil, tried to stunt your growth, tried to hide you under the earth. Bury your skin in a box, surround you in four walls, contain you in a wooden realm. Let earthworms make jagged tunnels out of your flesh. Let sections of your body seep from under you, oozing deeper into the ground. Let you become liquid. The skills of keeping alive are taught, become rituals in the mirror, readings to the child, imprisoning the true being, learning to bite your tongue to avoid the world swallowing you. Learning the taste of blood is better than the taste of dirt flooding your mouth, colonizing you whole. I have a few poems in here that focus on this one is called Interpreter of Maladies. There's a book by Jupiter Theory of that same title. I read this one summer and I was blown away by this book because the way she masters wordplay in these short stories, it's a collection of short stories, and the way that she mastered wordplay was just amazing to me. So I created this poem titled after that, and it kind of has to do with everybody in their life has dealt with somebody dealing with cancer or whether it be just whatever illness. And these maladies or these incidences, they affect our lives and they affect the way that we normally move throughout life. Disease is universal, though. There's no language for it. And so it can affect anybody. So I was just crossing different barriers of people and showing that disease affects anybody. And it's kind of something we all connect to, even if we speak different languages or we come from different cultures, it's something that we've all dealt with. So this one's called Interpreter of Maladies. Hospital waiting rooms are the best place to comprehend fish tanks, the miniature coral reefs and varieties of fish that exchange conversations with unstable minds. Counting the bubbles with an index finger against the glass, fogging the perimeter with your identification. I wonder about the battles fought in hospital beds, how these waters are the calmest thing this hospital knows. The tumor has grown inside of him. I compare the MRI scans to the width of the salmon, the color of the eel. You hear a man across the hall speaking in Russian and then crying. The kid sitting on the floor improperly playing Jenga, shouts of Spanish followed by silent discipline. The sirens can be heard every 10 minutes but are still foreign. I look into the tank and compare how we too are all animals conflated in a room from different countries. The fathers are dressed in suits for funerals at a moment's notice. Some nights, they sit around the aquarium and audience and count the stripes and spots on every living organism. On mornings, I press my face into my thighs, swallowing my pants with grief. I hold my palm to the back of a woman's shoulder who is praying in a language that I cannot dissect. We both look into the fish tank, wishing we could iron grains of white sand to our face. The doctor walks over and says, I have bad news. As her interpreter translates this catastrophe, she pushes her fist into the glass. The tank breaks. An exotic fish flap on the tiles and die. Thank you. This last poem in my book is called To Pimp a Bloom, which is the title of the section as well. Like I said, it kind of deals with standards that women have placed on us and how we have to live every day trying to confine to these standards and just live up to them. And it gets stressful, you know, just having these different standards placed on us. So this one's called To Pimp a Bloom. Mama tells me this is the last time I will wear cheap perfume. The last time I will smell like mixtures of poverty, the last of poor skin. She tells me girls wear stockings, that they cross their legs, hiding their wonders, and never lick their lips, letting them turn to raisins. I was told to wear pink bras and bows, to wear matching colors and dance like the spine of a notebook. We talk limited and dream in quiet galaxies. She told me, put baking soda on your teeth every morning. Never show war, never show battlefield. Starve if you have to. To pimp my womb to my husband at any hour in the night. She told me to wake up before the sun, to wake like lightning and be a whispering skipping stone. Collide with storms, but still be beautiful. Never bite your nails, never flaunt your collarbone. Know the role of a lover before you turn 13. She taught me ways to tease, taught me how to use all the watts in my womb, how to birth girls that would bear the same fruit. She told me this tradition was dragged in bloodlines by the flesh, said the woman that rebelled become flatlines in dirt. She took me on trips to the pedestal, let me wear the crown the girls shed blood for, the stains making confetti on their dresses. I wore it, walked in 4-inch heels to the pedestal. Just one more inch, and I would be touching God.
Like a freestyle kind of poet, like
I'll go and I'll listen to like instrumentals or just people watch or just sit down and just write what comes to my head, whatever is worrying me, whatever is weighing heavy on me, I'll write that. And wherever I leave off, I leave off. If, you know, like a lot of, when I was younger, like when I was 12, I was in a camp, what was the contest, Mom? It was called Let's Draw the Line or something like that. It was like a teens and drugs campaign. That's when I thought poems had to rhyme. So this was the poem, I'll do a little bit of it. Thoughts come back with the ashes, life passes, that dope you smoked didn't feel like what you hoped. Most kids want to grow up and be bright, but their futures are blurred by the fires that they light. Crack can kill, overdose on those pills, weeds green like those bills, over time you decide. So that was a little bit of the poem I did, and I thought poems had to rhyme, like every poem had to rhyme. So, but then I learned that, you know, it doesn't have to rhyme, you just have to, you know, evolve and learn different wordplay and how to use your, you know, creativity to be strong, so.
You were a student here, or are a student?
I am a student.
In what classes are, what's your focus? Like, what are you interested in?
So, I'm getting my AA right now. I'm going to be done pretty soon. I plan on transferring. I want to go to Howard University in D.C. It's a HBCU. I want to major in journalism. So, I'm really excited about that. Excited about leaving and just exploring the world. And just getting a different take on our society and, you know, just different things. Because I feel like with traveling, my poetry will expand. I'm really excited for that.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. So what's your role as the poet laureate?
My role? So when I was youth poet laureate, I feel like I had a lot of responsibility, like I said, to use my poetry as an act of protest. And I think I had a role, being from Seattle, Washington, to encourage artists from here to use their voice, because I feel like a lot of times in Seattle, we feel like we're overshadowed by, you know, bigger figures, like whether it be Macklemore or just other people that are kind of in the limelight, so we feel like we can't, you know, shine, but there's so many different platforms for us to shine. So I think that when I was Seattle Youth Poet Laureate, I just wanted to encourage people that you can have your own platform and you can thrive in the city if you have the proper resources behind you. I had Seattle Arts and Lectures behind me, so they were helping me. I had two mentors who helped me with my book, helped me learn about things like line breaks, I did not know what that was. I was like, what? And just the structure of a book, making a book and making it flow. So yeah, I had that role, and just, I think I had a role to my grandfather. Like I said, my grandfather was a Black Panther, and I always wish when he was still alive, I would ask him questions about, you know, what was it like when you were in the Black Panther Party, and just different things during that time. So I think I have a role to play to him, just to see, you know, you see what I'm doing now from heaven, but you see what I'm doing now, and I hope he's proud of me. So, yeah.
So who are some of your favorite journalists working today?
My favorite, that's a hard question.
Especially today.
I really like David Muir. He's a really good journalist. Angela Rye. She's more like a journalist, but she's more like a speaking, engaged person, kind of talker. Yeah, I like David Muir. I like Angela Rye. I read a lot more than I like actually see the news and stuff like that. So a few authors I like: Maya Angelou. I like Lindsay Hughes. Buddy Wakefield has some good poetry. Who else do I like? Malcolm London, he's a poet from Chicago. There's so many poets. I'll be sitting here all day if I try to talk. So I can't, yeah. But yeah. Mm-hmm. No other questions?
Do you think you might have time to help put together a resource list for these opportunities for students, for young people to write?
Of course, yeah. Yes.
Because you said you there's all this out there, but I don't know. I don't really see that. So.
Right, and that's why I feel like people should be enlightened and see that there are so many resources There's artist grants, you know, for you to make if you want to make documentaries or like cool things. There's just so many things for young people, especially to just, you know, play
the
towards.
Program she was just in.
Okay.
Yeah, because they're about to nominate another.
Yeah,
Laureate.
This,
they're in their final stage.
This May, because yeah, there's a new youth poet laureate. Her name is Angel,
mm-hmm.
and her time is almost up, so they're gonna have another person. They're actually coming. I'm coming back to judge for the next person.
That's
mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
What recommendations might you have for young or not so young creatives?
Who want to get into creativity?
Yeah.
I think I think people, a lot of people think that they have to perform their poetry. That's not necessary. I think that if you're willing to perform your poetry, that's good because it kind of opens you up to being vulnerable. But at first I was very nervous to perform poetry. The first time I actually performed was at the Let's Draw the Line campaign.
You were nervous?
Yeah. I was super nervous. Like, you couldn't tell?
You were 12 and you were like, where did she come from?
But yeah, I think that a lot of poets, they think that they have to perform their poetry. You don't have to. You don't have to be a slam poet if you don't want to. But if, I think with creativity, it just starts with being yourself. And only you can describe yourself the best that you can. And like I said, you don't have to share it. This is for you to keep. If you want to share it, that's totally up to you. But this is yours to keep. And with creativity, I think that you should just be aware of what's going on in the world and to kind of grab from that in your creativity. Like I said, with my creativity being about social justice, I grab from that. So whatever you want to grab from, it's up to you. Like, I remember my friend, she was like, I want to start like a clothing campaign, but I also want to be an activist, and I don't know how that's going to connect. I'm like, well, you know, you could make like t-shirts that say, you know, hashtag no new youth jail or Black Lives Matter or something. You could donate back to organizations. There's always a way that you can connect. So.
I have another question.
Mm-hmm.
So you said you were really like anxious about like performing at first.
Yes.
What about having your work published? Were you also anxious about that, or like was it a whole other type of?
Yeah. I think I was really anxious, especially since I have a poem called Gun, where I talk a lot about just how there needs to be stricter gun laws. And I got a lot of, like, I remember I searched myself one time and there was like this blog I was reading about me just saying horrible things and like, she doesn't need to be talking, just racist stuff. So I was definitely nervous at first to allow people into my mental space and just see what I was thinking. But in the end, I think it's important. And I think that the negative comments, they don't really matter at the end of the day. So I think I just got over negative comments and just listened to the positive feedback. So.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit about, you asked me, can you talk a little bit about some of the opportunities that have been presented to you being the youth poet?
Oh, okay, yeah, of course. So I got to open up for a lot of dope people. Saul Williams, I got to open up for Angela Davis. That was amazing. Like I said, being a part of a Black Panther family and just being able to open up for Angela Davis, I still can't believe it. I got to be on Sherm Alexie's podcast. He had me on there one time. Who else did I get to? Kevin Powell. I got to open up for Kevin Powell.
I'm pointing. I don't know what you did with.
Oh, Mark. I thought you were pointing. Sorry. I went to the women's prison with Mark a few times, and I actually spoke to the women. I did some poetry for them. I plan on going back and doing like writing workshops and stuff. Me and my mom today were supposed to be going to a juvenile detention. I'm gonna speak to the kids and do writing workshops. So I just got the opportunity to, you know, just be in the community and have different speaking engagements. last week, I think I spoke at a journalism convention, and I did a speech for like 30 minutes, and then the students, they like asked me questions, and it was really cool. So a lot of things come up, yes. Mm-hmm.
So Seattle Arts and Lectures, is it just for poets, or is it for other people?
I don't think it's just for poets. I think that they, I'm pretty sure it's for all types of artists.
All types of artists?
I think so. Okay. Don't quote me. Yeah. All right. Well, thank you guys for coming so much.
Is holding Outweigh the Gravity that she read from today. There are copies if you'd like to purchase one. I believe they're $10 a copy. Help support a fantastic poet, a student, your peer, and also a role model. So I think there's more than one book over there. I think there's your first book too, right?
Oh yeah, what's it called? The Young Urban Authors?
Yeah, which is another
thing. When I was a sophomore in high school, there's a program called Young Urban Authors, and they let you write books. It's like a 3-month program. So I wrote a poetry book with them when I was a sophomore.
I'm also passing out an evaluation form so you can tell us what you liked, how we can continue to bring relevant programming here, what you'd like to see. And I believe, let's see if you're still up for it, are you still willing to sign books that are purchased? Okay, fantastic. Please join me in thanking Leija again. And thank you all for being here again. If you'd like to purchase a book, you know this is the table.